So everyone, this is a viewer interactivity scheduled section of the Grimness Grimpocalypse live broadcast marathon, where, you know, I do this on occasion, where I just leave answer choices up to viewer poll, and we just see where we go from there. I've got some dice that I'll be rolling if there's any, like, thing that seems grotesquely, like too many damn options. Like, what's your favorite color? And there's, like, 8 options, I'll just roll. And I'll also be picking this option, because this will be the Chuckle Fuck Democracy's first playthrough. Alright? Is there not going to be a chat overlay? No. You know, Bloodfell, I like you. But I don't think it should be there, because it obscures the text. I guess it should be there. Let me move it to, like, the bottom left corner or something. Hold on. Because some of my viewers who just watch on YouTube. I don't care about you, StreamJar team. I'm glad you're online to answer my problems. Can you fix ScorpBot for me? There. There, we did it, everyone. That's right. Hello, YouTube. So, a note before we begin. By default, it's choose your own adventure story. I've done several of these on the channel before. I've done actual, like, in real life, holding in my hand books that we then did choose your adventure for in the YouTube comments. This is being played through Beam. I'm going to try out their whole poll system. I'm already disappointed by their giveaway system. I'm not mad. Anyway, just go ahead and randomize NPC genders. So, it's gonna probably be awesome. Or it might not be. This might just absolutely be a total dud. I talked with Manikai, a friend of mine who's gone through this before, and he said it was short. I haven't gone through this before myself. We'll just see where it goes. Alright, so I've got some text to read. There won't be that many words. But then you folks will be able to make your own decisions along the way. Mecha Ace, Heroes of the Vedrian War, by Paul Wang. Episode 1, A Struggle Amidst the Stars, The Battle for Vedria Prime. Orbit over Vedria Prime. I should probably change the game on Beam. I highly doubt this is listed on Beam, or whatever, like, player thing they do. Other game, or unknown game. There we go, unknown game? I actually don't know what the list is as, because, like, other game and unknown game aren't appearing. Professional. Whatever. Web show. I don't care. It's a web show. You pull back on the throttles as the battered Imperial combat armature in your sights begins to glow with the telltale light of a core breach. You shift your weight in your seat, your skin-tight pilot suit stretching as your own mecha's controls register your movement. Your multi-ton war machine halts just meters in front of the stricken enemy machine at the commands of your flesh and blood body inside the cockpit. With a twist of your legs, your control interface sends the 12 metric tons of your combat armature's leg crashing into the disintegrating enemy machine, sending it careening off into the middle of the enemy formation. Unlisted game. Let me try that. I knew I kept you around for a reason. All right, that worked. Beautiful. I'm happy. You made me happy. Good work. Crashing the disintegrating enemy machine, sending it careening off into the middle of the enemy formation. With a brilliant, self-annihilating flash, the crippled machine's matter-antimatter core goes critical, taking 2 other hostiles with it. Around you, more enemy machines die as allied mecha pours supporting fire into them, exploiting the hole torn in the enemy formation by your attack. Command had been wise to choose you, Chuckle Fox, to lead the attack, for you were an elite ace with 60 kills. Now you have 63. Their formation shattered, the enemy advance guard flees for the safety of their distant support vessels. Behind you, the main body of the fleet moves up to press the attack, allowing you and your fellow pilots in the advance group to regroup. You scan your tactical display, hoping to find and rendezvous with your unit. Instead, you find 3 dim energy readings heading away from you, each with the telltale signatures of escape pods. What do you do? Let me go ahead and what do? And we'll make this poll like 120 seconds long. Option 1, option 2, option 3, option 4. Oh good, it supports 5 options. There, so there's a poll up there at the top. What do goes sequentially top to bottom. Do we say killing helpless foes would be dishonorable? I let them go. I'm a soldier, not a murderer. I don't want to kill anyone I don't have to. Killing them would waste ammunition I could need later. I let them go. I cannot afford to let 3 experienced enemy pilots live. Why should I let those impy bastards live? I kill them all. That's right. And I set 2 minutes for that vote there. It gives me some time to recover my throat. It's still a little strained from the latest Grimness video I did. The musical. God rest ye merry, Chuckle Fox. So it's a little hoarse right now. I might set the voting to be like 90 seconds in the future. But for now, it is this way. And that is the way it shall be. How many layers? That was 12 distinct voices of me. No voice modulation, no voice editing. I do all that myself.
God rest ye merry, Chuckle Fox.
So, option 3 has narrowly edged out option 4 here by the looks of things. I think this thing tells me whenever the poll's over. It'll be like, da-da! Alright, read all the text for me. 60 votes. Not everyone wants to get up and vote. They're like reading in bed. Of course, when there's this many options, there might be a problem in that there's a tie. And it doesn't give me exact numbers of specifically... Okay. No, it highlights. All right, so option 3 narrowly edged out options 4 and 5. So killing them would waste ammunition I could need later. I let them go. We'll shorten down the polls to like 60 seconds in the future, I think. Let's try to read some of the next part in flog phone voice. If there's someone whose dialogue comes up that might be suitable, I do different voices. You lower your machine's weapon as you watch the 3 Imperial pilots escape to the safety of their fleet's defensive fire. The past 5 years of war between Earth and her colonies have been a traumatizing experience for humanity's collective psyche. You have seen those men and women whose good hearts have been broken by the slaughter, those who could wreak death and destruction without a second thought simply because they no longer saw it as something monstrous. Oh, that's what it is. The escape pods of your vanquished opponents disappear off the edge of your sensor display. You breathe a sigh. You are glad that you are not one of them. A voice brings you out of your pensive mood and into the here and now. Are you just going to let him get away like that, boss? The window on your comm screen displays the image of a black-haired young woman with full cherry lips, a snub nose, and skin the color of milk tea, her brow furrowed in frustration. Ensign Fatima Asadi, your wingman, possessed of undoubted talent and the instincts of a natural hunter, but vicious. Far too vicious for her own good. Hello, Zerfall. Welcome to Chuckle Fuck Democracy. It's good to see you. You look your wingman in the eye. I'm not going to waste my ammunition on helpless targets that can't shoot back. Yes, don't worry. Don't worry, shy guy. We'll do that. We'll do that for Ensign Fatima Asadi.
Are you just going to let them get away like that, boss?
I'm like 20 years separated from being able to do that pitch. Asadi gives a sigh of resignation.
One hot and ready pepperoni pizza.
As if she were your commanding officer instead of the other way around.
I'll have to take your word for it.
Oh, yeah. No. So? Are we a sir? Oh. I have to ask a longer question. Excuse me. All right, new poll. Are we a sir or are we a ma'am? Or do we not decide to identify by those preconceived gender notions, shitlords? This is for us.
All right, Fog. Welcome to Mecha 8.
Oh, man. My throat is trashed. It really is. Especially after all the talking I've done today and all the talking I did yesterday. I sound hoarse. I can't do that for very long.
Oh, boy. Maybe I'll just do my Elmo voice.
Man, I haven't done this much cracking since puberty.
All right, everyone. Welcome to Let's Get On With It.
The hypest voice utility available to you anywhere on Beam this morning. All right. By a margin of 56 to 44%, we are a sir. Elmo is becoming a man. All right. You nod your head.
Glad I've made myself clear, Asadi. You say as you look over your main display beyond your wingman's face and at the battle still raging before you, high above Vedria Prime's surface. Half a decade of war has honed your ability to pick out friend from foe to a razor's edge. Within seconds, you are able to pick out the friendly warships and combat armature units of the fleet as they open up against the main body of the hated enemy. They, like you, fight for the coalition of democratic extrasolar colonies. What the fuck kind of name is that? An alliance of human colonies fighting for independence from the growing tyranny of old Earth in...
The old Earth Empire of Humanity Ascendant.
Usually the go-to girl for voice acting and friend deity. It's good. It's good. It's important to have that friend. It's important to be that person or know that person. The rebellion itself had been centuries in the making, while the human species had needed strong central authority to govern it during the first uncertain decades of interstellar colonization. The organization that would become the Empire did not adapt the changing realities as Earth's colonies grew into powers in their own right. Ultimately, I don't know what we really can do in this game. We'll find out, I guess. No spoilers. Shh. Spoiler equals ban. Don't even joke about spoilers. That's not cool. Ultimately, the result had been a government who claimed to speak for all of humanity, but one which concentrated all power in the 1/7 of the human race that lived within humanity's home system. Fuck this. Instead of delegating power to the ascended colonies, old Earth has started bringing in its growing children with increasingly restrictive policies. When the outer colonies protested, the Empress and her court responded by stripping entire worlds of their charters and ruling by decree. After that, open rebellion had only been a matter of time. That's right, Train. What the fuck is this? This looks like a D6 option to me. Let me grab my dice. That's right, Train. Too many options. Who has time for options, Train? That's right. You tell them. You say options are bad. Okay. Actually, I'll kick this to a poll. And we'll go ahead and get the poll started right now. I hope this can do 6 options. It can do 5. Okay, good, it can do 6. Our life is complete. We'll set this to 90 seconds. In the early days of the Rebellion, the forces of Earth's rebelling colonies have been poorly organized and armed with nothing more than improvised weapons, warships, and combat armatures. You had been one of the first volunteers. The moment the concept of colonial revolution became something more concrete, you joined up with the newborn rebellion's ragtag armed forces. You had only one thing on your mind that day, and you joined the military as a combat armature pilot for one reason. Revenge? To support the cause of freedom? To shield loved ones from war? A chance for power and fame? To kill people with official backing? Or it's my duty? Well, I mean, are we a fame monster? Is it for revenge? You know, one of those fucking revenge stories? For freedom? To protect loved ones? Or, you know, like a sense of duty? Vengeance! Next game, folks, is the Typing of the Dead, which will have the interactive soundboard enabled. So there's that. Actually, oh boy. I hope Flog is asleep by that time. Actually, I need to, like, chase away all my viewers so that no one really has any sparks. Because that... Oh, that's not good. I didn't expect to have so many viewers around for this. This is awkward. All right.
Option four, it is. A chance for power, fame. Oh, that one. Oh no, Shy Guy. Shy Guy, I might have to ban you, Shy Guy. A chance for power, fame, maybe even high office at the end of the war. All right. We are a fame monster. I love it. When you signed up, you weren't thinking of the war itself, but what would happen afterward? Ultimately, I don't even think banning you would stop you from being able to use the soundboard, right? Ultimately, history is... Oh, shit, 30K. Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, no. That's... Oh, no. Ultimately, history is full of the stories of rebel soldiers who parlayed their heroic reputation into solid political and financial power once the war was won. Your goal is simply to become a hero of the rebellion, to leverage your reputation and daring acts of valor on the field of battle into promotion and public recognition. You knew the war to come was an opportunity to make your reputation, and that with luck and judicious application of your skills, you could end the war with wealth and power. As a hero of a successful war of independence, your potential advancement would have been limitless. Crowds of adoring adherents, a mountain of decorations bestowed upon you by a grateful regime, even a planetary governorship. All of these visions of your future glory sparkled in your mind's eye when you volunteered for battle. Over the next 5 long years of war, you watched the military turn into a cohesive fighting force, capable of facing the Imperial War Machine on even terms. During that time, you became one of the most elite pilots famously known for... Let's see here. We've got option 1, option 2, option 3, option 4. That is, single-handedly destroying 3 Imperial warships at the Battle of Crown Station, protecting a civilian convoy from repeated enemy attacks during the retreat from Toulon. No single act but from my passionate devotion to everything I do... No single act but for my utter reliability and unbroken history of excellent service. Now, you see, real boats rock, everyone. Real boats rock. So, if your record is perfectly pristine, without any blemishes, you're hiding something. That's a terrible sign of corruption and decadence and decay. Because real boats rock, remember that. That is Grimace wisdom. Real mode to rock. Take that with you. Thank you, Malarkey. I'm glad you love that. First option seems like the only glorious one. The poll has ended, and it looks like we will be going with that option. 3 years ago, the Imperials had tried to take Vedria the first time. Only instead of attacking the system's planets, they had tried to take Crown Station, the massive space station which guarded the link between Vedria and the other worlds. You had been part of the main fleet at the time, which meant you had been caught in the hardest of the fighting. It was there that you were able to penetrate the Imperial fleet screen in a mad dash forward and take down 3 enemy warships, including one of their prized Marshall-class carriers. High Command gave you a medal, a promotion in your own lance after that. The public exposure and prestige you got from your feat was even better. With the other 5 combat armatures of your lance rallying behind your machine, you look for a target of opportunity, an opportunity to throw your lance back into the fight. Your keen eyes soon find one. The telltale thruster trails of Imperial Fantons. Fontans, the most basic combat armature still fielded by the military. There are perhaps 2 dozen in all, moving forward in an attempt to outflank the advancing fleet. You turn to your wingman again. She meets your gaze, a vicious grin on her lips. It is clear that she is seeing the same opportunity you have.
More work, boss man?
You nod. More work. Pilots, rally on me and prepare to attack. You look around your cockpit, going through the practice motions of a pre-combat check. You know Asadi, and the other members of your lance will be doing the same. For them, such a check would be a formality, but you've just come out of a battle, and you go through every item on the checklist in earnest, looking for minor damage from your previous skirmish, mechanical failure alerts, or any other pressing issues. Finally, you ensure that your machine's primary weapon is in working order. You quickly check some things. What are the things that are checked? Give Paul.
You check the heatsink status of my long-range particle rifle, power linkages on my sword-like plasma cutter, or ammunition levels on my versatile autocannon.
Pew pew!
I know which option I think is the most badass.
Oh, strongly divided in chat.
More work, boss man.
No, my throat can't really do it tonight. It's not providing.
But perhaps so, Vice.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Mecha.
I can't. Throat's not complying.
It would be easier for me to do this voice. This will be the voice I give her. All right. Yeah. Shy Guy says big poles are awesome. He likes big poles and he cannot lie.
All right. Power linkages on my sword-like plasma cutter. Here we go.
You skim through the weapon power display, making sure that each of the four linkages on the screen show green. With a press of a button, the familiar hilt of your plasma cutter slots into the right hand of your... It is the work of half a second and the burst of your vernier...
All right.
To assume a classic fencer's pose, you touch the activator and a bright blade of blue flame, should have been green flame, blazes forth from the emitter. Long enough and intense enough to bisect an enemy combat armature in a single stroke. It is this formidable weapon, along with the Uxbridge's incredible speed and your own piloting skills, which have made you one of the premier aces over the years, a reputation which grows with every battle. Of course, it helps that your machine isn't exactly factory standard. Over the years, you've made a few modifications to your increasingly obsolete mecha. At first, they were just a few minor touches, new cockpit displays, a climate control unit, leather upholstery, stuff like that. It wasn't until you scored your 25th kill in the third year of the war that Command had given you permission to order the customizations you had really wanted, mainly a spa. I made that part up, everyone.
60 seconds, go.
A single stroke. Well, bam! Upgraded thrusters, which make my Uxbridge more agile. Improved sensors, which help me keep an eye on the battlefield. Cockpit armor, which makes me feel safer, more confident in battle. A custom paint job to encourage my allies and strike fear into the enemy.
Oh, wow. Pretty strong number one right here. Upgraded thrusters. It's better to not get hit, right? That's right, folks. It could have been like an orc mecha. We just paint like it red, put some stripes on it, it goes faster. Custom paint job, come on. Good times.
Play Milligan.
Okay. Upgraded thrusters it is.
The modifications hadn't even ended up being particularly drastic. All the tech crews really had to do was install new thruster nozzles capable of holding up under higher temperatures and removing the reactor governors. The result was a more powerful thruster system, which allows you to take advantage of your formidable piloting skills to their fullest extent. That's right, Vlog. Thrusters.
This is Lee, do you report? Ready for battle.
This is two,
Asadi responds, her voice as cocky as ever. That's totally a cocky voice.
Listen to...
Can't do it for...
Damn it, I'm gonna do this. Locked, loaded, and ready to roll.
After your wingman, the four other pilots of your lance report themselves ready for battle as well. The whole process takes mere moments. Your unit is comprised of some of the most promising pilots, each eager to prove their mettle, alongside a famed ace of yourself. This is where I wreck my voice, and then for like the next 12 hours of this broadcast, I'm just like... By following your example, over the 2 years you've led them, your strengths have become their strengths. Unfortunately, your weaknesses have become theirs as well. In a way, perhaps, they are disciples of your own unique combat style. Like every lance, your unit has a distinctive name, one which you picked yourself. Fuck those options. Something more original than that. It took you more than a small amount of thinking, but eventually you settled on Chuckle Fuck Lance. Yes!
Chucklefuck lands?
No.
Chucklefuck lands. Alright, no. What? Alright, Chucklefuck lands. Lands.
All right, Chucklefuck Lance Lance, form up on me and follow my lead.
Your unit forms up behind your combat armature with the grace of a ballet. They fly newer machines than your trusty old Uxbridge. Grinzers and Raiders. Models superior to your own, but strange and overcomplex to pilots used to the simplicity of the first generation of combat armatures. With your lance now flying in readiness behind your machine, you request authorization to begin the attack.
Caliburn, this is Chucklefuck Lance Lead, copy.
You glance at the lean, knife-like hull of the Caliburn as you send your message. The ship is almost brand new, one of the first purpose-built warships, a far cry from the hastily armed freighters and makeshift carriers you spend most of the war on. A moment later, you get a reply. A brusque contralto? What does contralto sound like? Okay. It's the lowest voice. It's the lowest female voice. A brusque would mean like curt, or like rude, or dismissive. Like curt. I already said curt. Just like short, to the point. Chucklefuck Lance Lance Dance Dance Revolution, that's right. I can't do that. Fuck it.
This is Caliburn, actual.
Barks of brusque contralto.
What do you want, Chucklefuck Lance Lead?
You wince a little at the hard tone on the other end of the line. Captain Balin of the Caliburn may be an excellent soldier and a tactical genius, but her interpersonal skills leave much to be desired. Sounds like another romance option to me.
Caliburn, requesting permission to attack contacts marked Delta 5-2 on scope. About 20 or so, mostly Phantons.
Granted, Chucklefuck Lance Lead. Good hunting.
Received and acknowledged, Caliburn. Actual out. You remain expressionless as you open the throttle and fly towards your targets. You take little joy in this endless killing, but there is a job to be done. As you approach the enemy formation, your keen tactician's mind takes over. Home to a fine edge over dozens of battles, skirmishes, and duels, you pick out your options even as your machine advances on the Imperial Force at top speed. Hello, the dude. The most obvious choice would be to hit the enemy head-on, but such a move would put you at the head of your formation, where you will draw the most fire and stand the most chance of colliding into an enemy machine. You would need an iron will and nerves of titanium to do such a thing. Alternatively, you could attack the enemy commander first, relying on superior piloting skill to quickly destroy or disable his machine, leaving his subordinates confused and uncoordinated. Another option would be to find a weak point in the enemy's formation and exploit it, something that would need excellent situational and tactical awareness. Lastly, you could attempt to strike fear into the enemy by hitting them with a showy, intimidating first strike. You would need one hell of a flair for the melodramatic to sell it, but it might make the enemy hesitate just long enough for you and your unit to win the fight. Ultimately, you decide to play to your strengths. And choose a thing. Time for Maxim Eldar. Let's fight smart. Perhaps so. And it looks like chat is voting that way. Like, if we chose the agility, then perhaps we should try to rely on brilliant piloting skills to excise with the precision of a surgeon wielding our scalpel plasma cutter. Tell them all to get wrecked.
Be the Red Baron of future space? Absolutely. The Red Baron of future space. One sounds like an armor thing, three sounds like a sensors thing, four sounds like a paint job thing. You know? Get some orcs in on this. At least that's my interpretation. I mean, you're in the chuckle fuck, Lance. Alright, 61%. You pick out the enemy commander easily enough. Imperial Command variant Mecha are hardly inconspicuous with their golden trim and ostentatious ornamentation. That sounds like some British shit right there during the American Revolution.
Alright, chuckle fuck, Lance. I'll take out their command unit. When you see him go down, follow me in.
You dial down your throttle, letting simple inertia send you towards the enemy units. Your own subordinates follow behind you, keeping a similarly low profile. You are almost within weapons range when the enemy spots your machine. You power up your thrusters as the Imperials throw up a hasty wall of defensive fire. Your machine twists and dances through the storm of enemy bullets, twirling through the firestorm at your skilled command. The enemy fire grows wilder and more panicked as you careen ever closer, but you are the master of your craft, and they cannot stop you. The enemy command unit rushes to engage you with its melee weapons as you close, but you are ready. Your plasma blade flashes out before the enemy can even move to strike you, sending the Imperial machine's weapon and forearm flying into the void of space. Your next stroke cuts the enemy machine in two.
With their commander out of the fight, the Imperial formation loses cohesion just in time for the remaining five Mecha of Chucklefuck Lance to join the battle, guns blazing.
You are in your element. Here, the Uxbridge's melee-focused armament and incredible speed truly begin to shine. Your machine twirls from one enemy to another, plasma blade rending metal and ceramic armor with each lightning slash. Some of the Imperials try to escape the burning reach of your agile machine, but not even the quickest of their machines can escape you. One by one, you cut down your foes. All around you, your unit fights with the skill and ferocity you've come to expect of them. Slowly, the Imperial defense begins to crumble. However, just as the tide starts turning your favor, your fatal weakness rears its ugly head. Now, we, of course, cannot be outmaneuvered by a superior enemy pilot, for there is no one capable of doing such a thing. But we must have a weakness. Damn it. And that will be three options.
So, which weakness is that going to be? We blindsided by an enemy who we didn't detect in time? Do we lose the ability to command the other pilots in the Chucklefuck Lance? Do we get the combat shakes? I mean, you know, tunnel vision, Chadcow. We don't have the best sensors. Clearly the Chucklefucks cannot be committed. I actually do like that option. The whole concept of the Chucklefuck just being completely unruly.
No! You can't control me!
And it is very close between blindsided and losing the ability to command. Getting the combat shakes was not too strong an option. Very close between number one and number two.
Okay, we're blindsided by an enemy. We don't detect in time. Barely edges out over option number two. Okay.
The warning is what saves you. You're on the tail of an Imperial machine, trying to get a clean shot in when Chucklefuck Lance, Three's face, suddenly appears on your main display, her freckled face a mask of alarm.
Sir, behind you!
You turn your machine around just in time to see an Imperial machine flying towards you at full speed, its mono saber held in front of it like a fencer. You barely have time to push your machine to the side in a gut-punching IG maneuver before your attacker roars past, lunging at the spot where you had been not a split second before. The second the enemy has passed you, your combat instincts take over.
You extend your Huxbridge's free hand, latching onto the enemy mech. Your teeth grind as the enemy machine's passing momentum twists your own mecha around in a tight arc, and you slam the blade of superheated plasma in your mecha's other hand deep into your opponent's vital systems. As the Imperial craft begins to shudder and glow with the telltale signs of core breach, you kick the wreckage of the enemy craft away and take a deep breath to calm your pounding heart.
Thanks for the save, Chucklefuck Lance 3.
Chucklefuck Lance 3 gives an impish little grin. Not a problem, boss.
With your head clear, you take another look at your sensor display, only to find it devoid of enemies.
Chucklefuck Lance, I'm not reading any hostiles on scope. Confirm?
One by one, the faces of your lancemates appear on the communications display. Each of them confirms there are no enemies left within sensor range.
Maybe we got them all,
Chucklefuck Lance 6 theorizes, with only the barest hint of conviction. I got one.
So did I,
Chucklefuck Lance 3 chirps cheerfully. Asadi seems smug.
I got three,
she turns to you.
How many did you get, boss?
You think for a moment. Six? Maybe seven? I won't know for sure until I can look at the combat footage. Your wingman's expression is not amused. You can tell that she's going to relish the day that she matches you kill for kill. In the meantime, you have a dozen enemy machines unaccounted for.
A moment later, another message comes in. It's the Caliburn. You open the comm line. The faces of your five lancemates are replaced by Captain Balin's stern, battle-scarred scowl.
Chucklefuck Lance lead. Status report.
Engage the enemy. No losses on our end, bud.
Let me guess. The enemy force just up and disappeared on you.
You nod. The captain responds with a look that might as well have said, I thought as much. Okay, Quinn.
Our sensor logs tracked about a dozen of them breaking off right after your lance hit them. They linked up with another lance and dropped planet side. Apparently they're headed for a high-priority objective on the planet's surface. Your new orders are to go in after them and secure that objective. I'm sending you the coordinates now.
The coordinates point to a civilian district without a single known military target within 100 kilometers.
Captain, what exactly are you sending us into?
Balin shakes her head sharply.
You're not clear to know.
Ma'am, we stand a much better chance of success if we knew what we were getting into.
And the captain fixes you with a stern look.
Chucklefuck Lance lead. I'm not even clear to know. Just get it done. Caliburn actual. Out.
Well, that was hardly helpful.
What was that about?
Asadi asks as soon as you reopen communications with your lands.
New orders, you reply. Rig up for re-entry. I'm sending you the coordinates.
Asadi's face lights up in anticipation.
More fighting, boss?
Not all of your lancemates share your wingman's enthusiasm. Some seem nervous. Chucklefuck Lance 5 even seems outright disgusted by Asadi's eagerness.
How do you respond? Respond with 1, 2, 3. So, aggressively, I'll let my lancemates just as fired up as I am. Neutrally, I don't want to upset anyone. Reluctantly, I've killed more than enough people today already. Are we fame monsters? Are we bloodthirsty monsters? I mean, what is best in life? Yes, from everything I learned while playing Knights of the Old Republic 2, a certain old bitch does not get upset at you for, like, choosing, like, anything other than just, like, this blah neutral pace. But at the same time, the game punishes you for attempting to choose that blah neutral pace. You know, you get rewarded for being super extreme in one direction or the other. And anything less than that is unacceptable. All right. So option two it is. Neutrally. I don't want to upset anyone. Aww. We care.
That's a maybe, Asadi. If we run into the enemy, we'll do what we get paid for.
Your wingman nods.
Then I hope we run into those impy bastards.
One by one, the members of your lance report themselves ready for atmospheric drop. Man, doing Flog's pizza ordering voice really hurts. Your main display shuts off, obscured by the layer of a blade of heat gel, which will protect your combat armature from the heat of re-entry. You position your machine over the drop coordinates, flying on sensors alone. Commencing re-entry, you announce. Chucklefuck, Lance, follow me in. With that, you and your Lance begin the blind descent into Vedria Prime's atmosphere. Let's see our stats. How we doing here? We got some good piloting, we're rubbish at perception, power and presence are there, we're more for deliberation than passion, and we're more of a diplomat than a warrior. We got 69 confirmed kills, the rep of 50. Got some speed, not too much armor on this mech here. There's some stuff there, and land status. I wonder what all these options here show, like a tech database. Oh boy, that looks like too much text for me to read. You want to learn about the history of the Interstellar War, everyone? I can't, no. No, no, you don't. I'm not even going to leave you on that page. I'm going to go get a drink. Well, I already have this water sitting up here. That's not exciting. Goodness. Old man Grimith.
Sorry about that. I just need to take care of my throat for the next 12 hours, you know?
Suppose I should turn off some light in my room.
I can open up the blinds. That'll shed some light on the situation. How dark and spooky do I look?
Not too dark, not too spooky.
Okay. Anywho.
Let's go. You know, I'm pretty well illuminated by this computer screen. I can just do that. Let's go, boss. To episode 2. Into the Lion's Den. Codex Secret Weapon. New Rodrigo. Alright. Time out. Goodbye, Darkfire. See you in 4 hours if you're still awake. New Rodrigo City. Vedria Prime. Vedria System. Just as a reminder, don't say anything about, like, the upcoming episodes or, like, content of, like, the game. Or even, like, joke about, like, what the spoilers are. Otherwise, you will be removed. New Rodrigo City. Vedria Prime. Vedria System. Your lance makes landfall on the surface of Vedria Prime with all the subtlety of rolling thunder on a clear summer day. Your ears ring with the crash of 65 metric tons of Mecha hitting the ground, a cataclysmic racket after spending so long in the soundless vacuum of space. You bring up one mechanized hand to wipe the re-entry gel from your external sensors. Your hands move to the controls and wiggle your machine's arms and legs around experimentally, readjusting yourself to planetary gravity. All around you, you know your lance is doing the same. One after the other, they report their machines functional, ready for battle, with most of the opaque heat gel that protected your craft during re-entry now puddling around your combat armature's feet. You look through the main display and get a clear view of your surroundings. Single look is all you need to know, that the Imperials have already done a real number on the city in their short time here. All around you, the debris of war stands mute testament to the virulence of the last few minutes. The streets are choked with flipped and crushed vehicles. One building just ahead of you sports a gaping hole where an Imperial machine clearly walked through it. Another has been reduced to a burnt-out ruin, its concrete walls pockmarked by the watermelon-sized craters of high-caliber autocannon shells. Buildings and cars aren't the only things wrecked on the ground, either. Splatters of blood mark the last positions of the civilians unfortunate enough to be caught in the destruction. There is little left of a human body after being stepped on by a multi-ton war machine. The Imperials did not linger. They did not have to. A combat armature unit could cause mass destruction simply by moving through a populated area. You can see more columns of smoke and wrecked buildings all around you. Asadi's face appears on your display, her full lips pulled taut, an expression of barely suppressed fury.
Bastards! Attacking civilians like this, we should make them suffer!
Well, folks, what do you think? Asadi's right. We should make the Imperials pay for this. We shouldn't jump to conclusions. Asadi is letting her heart rule her head. She needs to calm down. Oh. Chad here is about to tell Asadi to get fucked. Super diplomatic, Chuckle Fox. Ugh.
Do a barrel roll.
I'm sure she'll be fine. I mean, she's a romanceable option. She couldn't possibly die, right?
Right?
That's right. Okay. That's a clear victory right there. 50% for option 3. Asadi is letting her heart rule her head. She needs to calm down.
Settle down, Asadi. We don't know for sure if the Imperials did this on purpose.
Asadi grits her teeth in anger.
Are you saying those hippies come did this by accident?
You nod your head.
Do you know how much damage a unit of 60-ton combat armatures can do when its pilots are in a hurry? A lot more than this.
Your wingman bites back in angry response. She takes a deep breath.
Understood, boss.
Chucklefuck Lance 3's face pops up in your main display. Boss, we may have a complication. Your subordinate links your machine's cameras with your own. Through Chucklefuck Lance 3's hull sensors, you see a small group of civilians gathered around the contorted form of a child trapped under a block of fallen concrete. You watch 3 move forward and extend the arm of her combat armature. Gingerly, like a child picking up a penny, she lifts up the heavy block, allowing the civilians to pull up the trapped boy. You smile a little, your heart warmed by the fact that despite years of war, the men and women under your command still have their hearts in the right place. Chucklefuck Lance 3's expression is nervous as she maneuvers her machine back into formation. The civilians' cheers and cries of gratitude audible from your link to her cockpit. There's probably more civilians in distress out there. What do we do if we come across more? You think about your options as you bring the rest of your lance into the conversation. Stopping to help every local in distress may make you feel better, but every minute you spend freeing trapped children and injured seniors, old people, means that the enemy are another minute closer to achieving their objective. On the other hand, your ultimate job as a soldier is to protect and defend these citizens. It could be said that your responsibility to do so supersedes the immediate mission. After a moment, you decide a poll. 60 seconds, go. We should help any civilians we come across. We won't be able to stop the help, but we can move carefully to prevent more damage. We have a job to do, and it will be done. Civilians be damned. Okay, so option 3 sounds pretty much just like, fuck it, we're bulldozing through this shit. And option 2 sounds like you're trying to make careful steps. I know how I feel about this matter. Ooh, it's a tough fight between options 1 and 2. Ooh, that's close. Oh, it's constantly dancing between the two. Jeez. Oh, look at Quinn. Good work. 46% on my screen, with option 3 at a whopping 8%. Now, you know, I'm wondering here. Like, it's showing option 1. Does this have a tie option? Like, what happens if these options are tied? Like, does it just flash a color anyway? Because as far as I'm concerned, those graphs on the screen are still, like, even. I don't know. Is anyone familiar enough with the polling system on Beam to tell me that for sure? Of course, it auto-evaporates. Let's see here. Yeah, it said 46-46. I am tempted to roll for it. I'm willing to give... I'm not going to go with second poll. We got, like... We're not going to get through this entire game with this video. What it does is auto-picks a winner via RNG. Well, alright, day Hades. Does it for me. I don't even need a dice roll. I love it. That's great. I guess it did that, you know, when those 6 options. Alright, cool. I'm glad for it. We should help any civilians we come across, then. By the slimmest of margins. Heads up, Chucklefuck Lance. There are still civilians in the area, so we need to move carefully to prevent any more damage. If any of you come across non-combatants needing help, let me know and we'll give them a hand. Asadi objects almost immediately.
Is this a joke, boss?
She asks, her voice incredulous. I'm serious, Ensign, you reply, emphasizing your wingman's inferior rank. I'm serious, Ensign. Our first duty is to the people of the colonies. Everything else is subordinate to that, even our orders. Asadi gives a noncommittal grunt. She is clearly displeased with your orders. Thankfully, she doesn't disobey them when you continue to stop and aid civilians, though you can tell that your wingman is holding back no small amount of impatience. Your halting journey seems to take an eternity. The paths left by the enemy machines are obvious, but you seem to stop every other step for the sake of another local in distress. Eventually, stopping to aid every civilian, indeed, even begins to grate on your patience. Finally, you and your lance track the Imperial Mecha to the entrance of a large subterranean passage, wide enough for 3 or 4 combat armatures to enter abreast. Judging by the wreckage of armored vehicles and bodies strewn in front of and just inside the entrance, your quarry awaits somewhere within.
Alright, Chucklefuck Lance, this looks like the place. Weapons at the ready.
Oh, excuse me. Weapons at the ready, you slowly move your uxbridge into the darkened passage downwards.
Follow my lead.
Because she wants to hurry and go kill people. And helping civilians is not help her go kill people. The 6 machines of your lance push forwards into the darkness, weapons at the ready, and expecting a fight. You don't find one. Instead, you find the passage splitting into a series of tunnels, each stretching into the darkness far beyond the light thrown out by your hull-mounted searchlights. This particular underground complex is larger than you had first thought.
Just great, Asadi says. What the hell do we do now?
You weigh your options. Tactical Gontrim would normally require you to sweep through each and every passage as a unit, proceeding slowly to forestall any attempt at ambush. Of course, these are not normal circumstances. With time of the essence, it might be better to split up and cover each of the passages individually. Then again, there's always your own experience and intuition to rely on. You could simply try to track the enemy forces using your own skills.
Now, option one, of course, is following, like, loyal tactical doctrine. Option two sounds like someone's gonna get fucked. And option three doesn't sound like an option we're really good at doing, what with our poor sensors and our lack of perception. You know, our amazing sum of perception. Just throwing that one out there.
This is why I wanted scanners. That's right, razor sharp.
Damn. Damn, that's a crushing margin for number one.
Okay.
Oh, I like Chucklefuck Democracy so much. It's fun.
All right. We sweep the complex as a unit.
All right. Formal Chucklefuck Lance, we do this one by the numbers. Check your corners and keep your eyes peeled.
With the precision of veteran soldiers, your lance forms up behind you, weapons at the ready and covering every angle, your searchlights shining out in every direction. Slowly but surely, you advance down each corridor, keeping an eye out for any sign of enemy activity. You find bullet-riddled bodies, crushed weapon emplacements, and metal sliced into pieces by the telltale perfect cuts of monomolecular blades. Still, you find no sign of the enemy. You lead your lance down passage after passage until finally, after what seems like half an eternity, you turn the corner to find lights flickering in the distance. Someone else's. With a gesture of your machine's gargantuan hand, you signal your lance to stop. Dialing down your throttle to the minimum possible, you creep forward, trying to make as little sound as possible in hopes of getting a better view. You blink in amazement as your eyes adjust to the light. Before you is a massive cylindrical subterranean vault, perhaps 100 meters tall and 3 times as wide. On the far end of the vault, you see more mangled bodies and crushed armored vehicles. Among them stand the Imperial combat armatures which you have been pursuing. Unfortunately, it seems the enemy has had plenty of time to set up proper defensive positions thanks to your delays in pursuing them. You see sentries on guard around the main position, all covered by overlapping fields of fire. The enemy pilots you will be facing will be alert and prepared for battle. As you quickly run through a tactical assessment of the Imperial machines, something else catches your eye. Behind all the shapes of the Imperial, the enemy lies a supine metal of metal, a supine pile of metal, gleaming white under the harsh lights of the Imperial machines. It is clear that this is what the enemy force is after. You zoom in on your hull camera feed to get a closer look at it. The heap of white metal soon coalesces into the familiar shape of a combat armature, but is unlike any mecha you have ever seen before. Its lines are smoother, more rounded than the makeshift form of your own Uxbridge, but is clearly of a different breed than the Imperial units around it. Your eyes catch on an insignia on the shoulder of the unidentified machine. Your eyes widen as you recognize the decal as a designation marker for a military prototype. It does not take an idiot to put two and two together. The identity of the high-priority objective, which Captain Balin told you about, is now blatantly clear. You beat a stealthy retreat and return to the shadows where you can confer with your lancemates without fear of discovery.
It's a prototype machine, you tell your lancemates as you feed them the recording from your machine sensors. That's why the Imperial's broken here, to capture that carbon armature.
Asadi says exactly what everyone else must be thinking.
We have to get it back.
A stolen prototype in enemy hands could be disastrous, and not only because the Imperials could easily turn its advanced weapons against your allies in orbit or the civilians on the ground. Should the Imperials reverse engineer this cutting-edge experimental equipment, they would be that much closer to getting a tech edge, which might even win them the war. Asadi's right. You have to get it back. Hello, Steel Shadow.
You lay out your options for the benefit of your lancemates.
The most obvious option would be a direct frontal assault on the enemy position. With your previous decision to keep your unit together, you are more than ready to strike immediately before the enemy can further reinforce their defenses or discover your presence, an added advantage. Alternatively, you could try to use the twists and turns of the darkened passages to lure your enemy into an ambush set by the rest of the machines in your lance. Lastly, you could try bluffing your enemy into surrendering or retreating by making the enemy think that they were outnumbered or surrounded.
Boss?
Chucklefuck Lad 3 speaks up.
There is one more thing we could try.
She scratches her head nervously as you gesture for her to continue.
Well, our machines have remote-controlled systems to fly us to safety if we get knocked out or something, right?
What if you used your command code to interface with that prototype and remote pilot it out? It'd make for a nice distraction, at least. Chucklefuck Lance 3's idea certainly has merit. Of course, there's the fact that you'd have to effectively pilot two combat armatures at once to pull it off. Ultimately, do you decide to be a badass? Let me go ahead and make this poll. Oh my goodness. I know what I'm fucking voting for. Oh, that's not even a close poll. A frontal assault, I mean, the game did laud us. Because we're all together, but we did spend so much time delaying that the game also makes it sound like that's pretty rough. Luring the enemy into an ambush might have been better if we had separated a bit. I don't know. Remote hijacking the prototype unit, our character is certainly the best at piloting. Yeah. Completely dominates the other options. 75%. I'm totally fucking cool with that too. Welcome back. It went great. That Oregon Trail 1.2 run totally went great. Didn't die two miles from the rafting or anything. Nope, didn't do that. Nope, didn't happen. Nope. All right, 75%. Here we go. Or it gets destroyed, right? I mean, look at us. I mean, we're kind of a badass. Achievement. Grand Theft Prototype. You've recovered a prototype from the enemy. Spoilers achievement! God! Thankfully, now that you know about the prototype, you can simply connect with its command and communication system from your current position. You activate your Uxbridge's networking system and probe for open systems. Flipping past the active connection nodes of your lancemates, you find an unfamiliar node, the prototype. You order your machine's tactical computer to connect to the inactive machine's own system. You enter your 16-digit command codes when the prompt comes up, hoping that your codes will give you the clearance to access the necessary systems. Luckily, the remote access combat arbiter's computer accepts your authorization and begins activating. Even better, a quick glance at the experimental model status reveals that the machine's remote sensors and piloting controls are both installed and integrated. In fact, every single primary and secondary system in the entire machine is reading as ready for action. You wonder how close to completion this prototype was before its development was disrupted by the Imperial attack. Asadi's curiosity finally gets the better of her.
Any good, boss?
Her face lights up when you give her and the rest of your lands the news.
I don't suppose active remote-controlled weapon systems would be too much to hope for, would it?
If you could use the prototype's weapons, as well as its piloting systems, and the havoc your diversion would be able to wreak would increase dramatically. Hoping against hope, you take a look.
Primary weapon systems. Ammunition capacity 2 out of 12. Status active. Awaiting remote control.
How about that? Feeding the prototype's cockpit displays into your own and those of your lancemates, you make a quick scan of the Imperial formation from the perspective of the deactivated prototype machine. Taking care not to move any physical components and tip off your enemies, you quickly identify three possible targets. The most obvious targets are the enemy mecha at the very edge of the Imperial formation. By taking out the units who would normally engage your own lance first, you would be able to wreak a lot more havoc before the other machines in the Imperial force could reposition to attack you. However, if your attack falters, the enemy would still be in position to wipe you out. Only slightly less obvious is the chamber itself. One of the support columns keeping the ceiling up has been obviously damaged by the Imperial attack. Should you destroy it entirely, it would likely drop a big enough chunk of the roof to crush everything under it, including at least 5 or 6 enemy machines. Of course, you are also right below a city. Collapsing a part of the ceiling might also bring the civilian buildings over it down as well. The cost in civilian lives and property damage could be staggering, especially for a group that chose to help the children and old people. Lastly, there is the unit which has singled itself as belonging to the Imperial Commander. Unlike most of the other units, it boasts the distinctive lines of an M414 Grognard, a machine assigned only to the best of the Imperial military.
Hey, boss. I'd like a hot and ready pepperoni.
Asadi's expression seems to be a combination of apprehension and anticipation.
You think you can clear me a path of that command unit? I never fought a Grognard before. They say those things are better than anything we have. I want to see for myself.
What will you target? Target. Option two, option three, 60 seconds. Go for the good of the city.
I know what option I like.
All right. It's pretty divided between options one and three. Some folks perhaps hoping to volunteer Asadi get killed.
She's made out of shit, although it might look bad on our permanent record, folks. Who can say in this game?
Option three to deny Asadi. Well, it'll be interesting to see. Sounds like Asadi wants us to clear a path to the commander, which would probably end up being through the perimeter guards. Of course, we could choose to target the commander ourselves. Don't know how exactly confused these folks will be, though, because they seem very well entrenched. And the support column, which does not have many votes at all, would possibly damage the entire city. All right, 45% to 41%. We're going to target the enemy commander with these experimental weapons. And see where we go from there.
Lance, attack on my order.
You carefully calibrate the prototype's targeting computer and set its weapon crosshairs on the Imperial Command Mecha. For a moment, you take a closer look at the cutting-edge enemy machine. You have heard stories about this, about how it has outmatched everything in the arsenal thus far. If you could disable or even destroy it now, you may be able to save your lance a lot of grief. Hoping that whatever weapon the prototype is, it's equipped with like a party popper. Like fucking like confetti shoots out. Surprise! Like it's actually meant to be like a party like prototype. Hoping that whatever weapon, bank flag. And hoping that whatever weapon the prototype has been equipped with is powerful enough and accurate enough to do the job. Yes. Yes, Luffy. You slave the fire controls to your own machine and squeeze the trigger. The gleaming prototype machine springs to life. With movements as fast as lightning, the mysterious combat armature springs to a firing stance. The prototype's weapon flares with energy, bathing the chamber in pale blue light. A pulsing beam, visible for a split second, fires from the prototype and hits the Grognard dead center in the chest. The enemy machine tumbles back, a massive black crater marring its frontal armor. Before it can regain its balance, you shift your aim and fire again. The shot goes through and downs the formidable enemy machine for good.
Juggle fuck Lance, charge!
That's right, Train. Your unit springs into action, pouring into the chamber and engaging the distracted perimeter guards. Asadi shoots you a dirty look as she advances to attack.
Relationship padlocked.
Apparently she wanted to fight that command unit more than she had let on. That's right, Train charges too. With your lance mates engaging the enemy directly, you are free to move the remote-controlled prototype machine to safely, but you barely move it two steps before a pair of Imperial pilots finally catches on. Vaulting over the melee with their Vernier thrusters, the two enemies rush to attack you. You disconnect your machine's controls from the prototype and prepare to defend yourselves. By the time you get your Uxbridge's weapons out, the enemy are just 100 meters in front of you, their autocannons at the ready and pointed at your cockpit.
What do you do, Train? Train! Train! What do you do? What do you do, Train? Train, tell me. Tell me your secrets, Train.
So, what do you folks want to do?
Get some distance and attack from range? Chad doesn't want to do that. Get in close and personal, or try to find a way to fight dirty?
Get distance sounds like a great idea for a sword user.
Let's see here. We got 71% for option 2, and 20% for option 3, 26% now.
Chuckle fucks are bastards. We had to fight dirty. Dirty, I know. 100 meters is nothing for our thrusters.
Salient point.
Alright. Good times.
Hey, this has been pretty fun. I like this.
This is great.
If we don't finish this, I'm definitely going to run this on Thursday. Okay, option two it is. Getting close and personal. You open the throttle as far as it will go, sending your Uxbridge barreling towards the enemy plasma cutter at the ready. Despite us not being fucking prepared at all, right? The first Imperial pilot doesn't even have a chance to react before you ram a 12-meter long stream of superheated plasma into his cockpit. You try not to think about your counterpart's last instant as he's immolated in his cockpit by your plasma blade. Jesus! Lube that up or something, Christ! By the time you get to the second enemy, he is ready for you, his monosaber held in front of him like a fencer's foil. The Imperial parries your first swing and barely dodges your second, but when you hop your Uxbridge backwards in a classic feint, your opponent takes the bait, lunging forward into the whip-like slash of your plasma blade. You look around for fresh enemies, only to find the battle nearly over. All throughout the chamber, you see your lancemates finishing off the last remnants of the enemy force. The scars and scorch marks on both fallen machines and the chamber walls bear mute testament to the viciousness of the fighting. You call up your lancemates,
Chucklefuck, Glance, Lance, casualty check.
Miraculously enough, your lance has taken no losses. Though many of your units' mech are damaged to some extent or another, you have made it through without losing a single pilot. There is, however, no time for celebration. Your job isn't done yet. You order your lance to secure the perimeter as you turn to the top-secret prototype Mecha. Suddenly, you receive a new comm line from the Caliburn, marked High Priority. Captain Balin's face pops up on the display as you open the line.
Chucklefuck Lance lead.
Excuse me.
Chucklefuck Lance lead. Status report.
We followed the enemy force to an underground complex and engaged them. No losses on our end.
Captain Balin seems to have no interest in casualty counts.
The objective, is it secured?
You link the captain to your mecha's hull cameras and point them at the limp form of the white prototype machine.
That depends. Is that our objective?
The captain shrugs, her scowl even deeper than usual.
Apparently, I'm not clear to know.
You get a feeling that she doesn't like being left in the dark any more than you do.
It looks important, though. Does that thing have standard remote command functions?
You check the link you had used to hijack the prototype machine earlier. Everything still seems to be working as intended.
Looks like it, ma'am.
Balin gives you a joyless little nod.
Good. Set that thing to fly up into the Caliburn for recovery. I want the rest of your lance securing the area and tying up loose ends, and I want you to escort this machine up. Understood?
By the time the Caliburn's commanding officer has finished speaking, you are already preparing your machine for space.
Understood, ma'am.
Okay. Neat. Well, I guess we're leaving this to Asadi, our wingman. I'm sure they'll secure everything perfectly. I'm sure they got this in the bag. Mm-hmm. Be fine. Yep. It'll be great.
Episode 3, motherfuckers. Yeah. Confirmed kills 72. Everyone is still alive. Kick ass.
Sonny would never make a wrong choice. Please remember to go and say right through the city. Episode 3. Enter the Blue Mask. A clash of aces. Orbit over Vedria Prime, Vedria System. You take a long, peaceful moment to savor the airless quiet of space as your Uxbridge breaks free from Vedria's atmosphere, flying close to the autopiloted prototype machine which you and your lance fought so hard to secure. Vedrian orbit looks far less peaceful than it sounds, though it lacks the thunderous rattle of autocannon and the mechanical whines of burning verniers which so dominate the audioscape of service conference. Sorry.
Which so dominate the audioscape of surface combat, you wouldn't understand. I'm an audioscape connoisseur, peasant.
The battle raging in orbit is of greater magnitude than the skirmish you just left behind you. Here, the half-kilometer-long warships of the Caliburn's battle group push back against the attacking Imperial task force, pouring fire at each other at close range. In the distance, you see the lead elements of the enemy force begin to retreat from the battle, as the Caliburn and her consort salvo wave after wave of megaton-range warheads at the Imperials. Before long, the entire Imperial force begins its slow, lumbering withdrawal. It seems that the battle in orbit is slowly, irrevocably, being won. Hey, Stars, how do you feel? Option 1, option 2, option 3, option 4, and option 5 for 60 seconds. Jealous? I could have gotten more kills if I'd stayed in orbit. Disappointed? Chucklefuck Lance Lance could have helped in this battle faster. Proud? We've done it. We've protected Vedria from the Imperials. Sad? I know far too many people have been killed today. Doesn't matter. We did our duty. We earned our pay. We didn't die. Good enough for me.
All right. Looks like Chad is keeping the mercenary attitude in check. Doesn't matter. We did our duty. We earned our pay. We didn't die. Good enough for me. Get that fame and respect, baby. Whatever. It's fine. We apparently did a cool thing. We got like a prototype mech. No biggie. Stars, I've only been broadcasting for 6 hours and 40 minutes. It's cool. No worries. All right. By 42%, option 5 it is.
After 5 years of war, one more victory doesn't weigh on your mind or fire your heart any more than one more defeat. The long years of campaigning have made you wise in that respect. Any triumph today could be reversed by defeat tomorrow or vice versa. The important thing was that you survived, and that the ramshackle little organization that a younger and more naive you dedicated to fight for all those years ago will exist long enough to pat you in the back for doing your job with some level of competence and clear your next paycheck. Some might call you cynical for thinking like that, but you know well enough that a cynic is just what hopeless optimists call a realist. Mind blown. The sharp beeping of the proximity alarm pulls you out of your thoughts and back into the battle. Your tactical display shows two contacts with hostile markers heading straight for you and the prototype you are escorting. A closer look reveals them to be nothing more than a pair of M401s, carrying only the most basic equipment. Once more, they're flying straight and slow, the mark of new and undertrained pilots. You had been like them once, thrown into battle in the first frantic weeks of the war, with only a few dozen hours of training. The Imperials had decimated your fellow pilots then, but those that had survived had gone on to become battle-hardened veterans. That was years ago. Now it is these luckless Imperials who find themselves outmatched by you. The Imperials close in with the eagerness of untested amateurs. You know that the very lowest rung of the Imperial military is made up mostly of conscripts. You also know that even non-hardened pilots can do a great deal of damage if you do not respond immediately. As the Imperial Mecha enter weapons range and prepare to attack, you make the decision to evade them, using our incredible piloting skills, fire off a few pot shots to scare them, with, you know, our incredible, like, arsenal of ranged weaponry and our fancy paint job, or attack them, and, let me go ahead and make the pull here. Tag to make sure neither enemy machine escapes.
I mean, we sound pretty fucking important here. Sound like a pretty big deal. We were told to report back immediately. And we got this prototype here that we're walking around with.
Wouldn't want them to damage the prototype. That'd be tragic, right? It's like, ah, oh, god damn it! Motherfucker!
But then again, padding the kill counter, huh? Kills, fame, respect. These two later come back to kill Chucklefuck Lance 3.
their bombs, calling it, It's possible that our character isn't very perceptive. Well, it's not possible, it's true. So, you know, he might miss out on details like those. Let's just evade the enemy mecha, then. You pilot your Uxbridge towards the autopilot of prototype and quickly slave its autopilot controls to your own machine. You open the throttle as the Imperial machines open fire, sending streams of shell and tracer flying all around you. Surprisingly enough, the Imperials are even worse shots than they are pilots. Their fire goes wide. As your machine accelerates, you pull it up into a sharp turn upwards, taking the prototype along with you. The Imperial pilots continue firing at the spot where you were until you are long gone. After a few seconds of searching to their left or right, but not above or below them, the two pilots wisely decide to break off, chuckling at the incompetence of your would-be attackers. You reset the prototype's autopilot and continue on your way. A moment later, you receive a message from the Caliburn.
Chucklefuck Lance Lead. We're prepping Hangar 8 to receive the package. Status report.
You consider your brief encounter with the enemy, then shake your head.
Nothing dangerous, Captain.
Good, keep me informed. Caliburn out.
You were getting close to the Caliburn now. It would only take a few more minutes to get the prototype machine to the carrier's hangar bay, but as you approach safety, you also fly closer and closer to the battle itself. At this distance, you can make out the shapes and forms of individual mecha. You watch as an allied lance of Grinzers streak across the sky ahead of you and fire their particle rifles into the side of a retreating Imperial light cruiser. Needles of pale blue light pierce through the enemy warship, and it soon falls behind the retreating Imperial formation, plasma and atmosphere bleeding from its drive pods. Your eyes are pulled from the sight by a call for the surface.
Boss? You got a hot and ready pepperoni?
Sadi's face appears on screen.
I didn't want to bother you with this, but Chucklefuck Lance 4 insisted.
We found something, boss, Chucklefuck Lance 4 says, her face appearing in a new window on your display. It's a container marked top secret. It's sealed tight and none of us has the clearance to open it. I'd wager pretty safe odds that somebody considered this thing important. Whatever it is, it weighs something like 500 metric tons. We'll need two of us to lift it. Asadi shakes her head.
I don't want to waste our time dealing with this, not when we could still be hunting for enemy stragglers.
Chucklefuck Lance 4 purses her lips. Our fight with the Imperials did a lot of damage to the complex. The place is falling apart. We might not have a chance to retrieve it later. Ensign Asadi
sighs because this is her life right now. God damn it.
There we go.
Is this Asadi's life? Yes or no?
I know. I think Chucklefuck 5 is male, or Chucklefuck 6. But certainly 2, 3, and 4 have proven to be female. Good work.
Love this vote.
96% say yes.
Do whatever Asadi doesn't want to do. If we just keep screwing her out of kills, she'll never catch up to us.
Yeah, I haven't lost anyone yet. I know, it's number 3 is our love interest. Absolutely.
Good times. Don't want her to catch up to... That's right, damn it.
93%.
The contents of that box might be critical. Get it somewhere safe immediately.
Asadi jumps forward in her seat. Boss! You shake your head at Asadi's protest.
No! I want this box to take priority.
From the other window, Chucklefuck Lance 4 nods.
Got it, boss. We'll move this thing to the surface and prep it for retrieval.
Chucklefuck Lance 4 out. Your wingman gives you a dirty look before signing off.
Chucklefuck Lance 2. Out.
No. Chucklefuck Lance 2. Ow. Damn it. Fucking hot and ready.
In the distance, the crippled Imperial vessel lashes out furiously with its point defense guns, dappling the darkness around it with bursting shells, but the attacking machines come in for another pass, picking off gun after gun with precisely aimed shots.
One by one, the defiant turrets of the wounded warship fall silent. As the cruiser's last guns fall silent, Caliburn and her escorts fling a vast salvo of missiles at the now defenseless enemy vessel. The attacking Mecha back away as each one of the warheads hits home in a self-annihilating flash of antimatter. Explosions ripple across the stricken vessel's... Let me read chat here. Vessel's hull as bodies... It sounded like everyone else is down there on the surface. And the captain said specifically, "We come alone." Explosions ripple across the stricken vessel's hull as bodies and fragments of metal are blown free, shimmering in the light of death and the Vedrian suns. Section by section, the ship's plating begins to fold and buckle as the ship's variable mass fields begin to fail. Entire portions of the hull crumple like sheets of paper crushed by a gigantic, invisible hand. Finally, a bright light emanates from the deepest recesses of the disintegrating vessel as it suffers a catastrophic reactor containment failure, consuming every part of it in a single violent flash of unleashed exotic matter. 500,000 metric tons of metal, ceramic, and plastic, 600 lives, snuffed out in the space of 8 seconds. Their target destroyed, the attacking Mecha back away from the slowly spreading field of wreckage. One by one, they return to their formation to seek out another target. Unleashed until one of them explodes. More out of morbid curiosity than anything else, you magnify your main display, centering on the Allied forces. They quickly assume a defensive formation. It doesn't help them. Their attacker, and there is only one, is too fast for them to catch. Lances of pale blue fire pierce the dark heavens, but the Imperial Mecha among them evades them all with a speed and grace that even your veteran skills be hard-pressed to match. The enemy machine moves so swiftly that it barely appears as a blur of fire and metal on your display, twirling through your distant allies, monosaber shimmering in the sunlight. Sonic? Shit. One by one, the machines are cut apart. Soon all six are nothing more than burnt-out hulks or rapidly expanding clouds of debris. For a moment, you see the mysterious Imperial attacker, lit by the explosion of its last opponent. At first glance, it seems like a modified French name, a quick and versatile but aging model of Imperial Mecha. It should have been no match for one Grenzer, let alone six. In fact, you can see very little that would distinguish it from a normal Imperial machine, save for its striking blue and silver paint scheme. Blue and silver. You break out in a cold sweat and begin to hear yourself breathe hard as you recognize the Imperial machine's distinctive colors. They are the custom paint job of the highest scoring ace in the Imperial military, Commandant Camille Hawkins, the Blue Mask. Romance? The Imperial ace's machine turns around with the grace of a ballet dancer. With a burst of flame, it begins moving again towards you. Okay. It's male. It's rude to identify people's genders based on their names. We have learned something today. Still a romance option. You barely even have time to prepare yourself. The Imperial machine approaches with blinding speed. Your chances of fading or otherwise outrunning the rapidly closing Imperial Mecha are slim. A comm window blinks open on your main display. You find yourself face-to-face with a pale-faced man in Imperial officer's pilot suit, perhaps in his late 20s. His features are gentle, perhaps even cherubic, despite his earnest expression. A sky-blue mask, fashioned to look like a knight's visor, covers the top of his face from his upturned nose to his mop of unruly golden blonde hair.
Good day, pilot.
Or do I want to use the... I don't want to use the snooty noble voice.
How seductive can I make this? Good day, pilot.
His voice is a smooth, rich baritone, laced with all the gentlemanly eagerness of a knight errant from a bygone age.
I'm sure you know who I am. What do you want?
You reply almost involuntarily.
Want?
You imagine a golden eyebrow rising in question behind the inscrutable face of that archaic mask.
I suppose I shall want that white machine you are escorting, but ultimately, 'tis nothing more than a prize to be won.
Hawkins' machine comes to a gentle stop, just outside of your weapon's range. For such a prize, I would request that you do me the honor of fighting for it in single combat.
Well, that was unexpected.
Your options flash through your mind as the Imperial Ace awaits your response. Your tactical display shows only a few friendlies nearby, and all of them seem either engaged or clearing the area. It seems that none of them want to be the Blue Mask's next victim. With the ships of the fleet wholly focused on matching missile broadsides to their Imperial counterparts, they won't be able to come to your aid either. It looks like you're going to have to face the famed Imperial Ace alone, unless... your allies in orbit may have no reason to throw themselves in the Blue Mask's way, but if you ordered your own Lancer from the surface, they'd be duty-bound to help you. Your units should be able to split up to aid you and recover the box they found at the same time. It would take them some time to reach you, but if you were able to hold off the Imperial Ace for long enough, you would outnumber your solitary opponent. Then again, Hawkins' insistence on challenging you to single combat might mean that he won't attack you if you were to refuse the challenge. It's a risky choice, but if it means avoiding a fight with the Imperial Ace, it might be worth a try. Lastly, you could always accept the challenge. Hawkins' custom gives him an advantage that you can't match, and his formidable reputation as a pilot must certainly be considered, but if you were lucky enough, or good enough, to actually beat the Empire's top pilot one-on-one... The Imperial machine before you points the blade of its mono saber directly at you. Your time is up, pilot. I have challenged you, sir. How shall you answer? Here is a review of the personal status, skills we have. This is our armature. Upgraded thrusters with a plasma cutter as our primary weapon. And we emphasize speed over armor. Everyone else is alive on the lands. So it sounds like the Blue Mask has some really good piloting skill. We have really good piloting skill. Let me go here. Do we accept? What do we do? Is the poll question. Option 1, option 2, option 3. 60 seconds. I mean, we don't have armor, but you don't really want to fucking be hit. You just want to fucking... It's a ballet. It's a fencing thing. He's a fencer, right? Oh, Chad agrees with me. Chad wants to do this shit. Chad wants to throw the fuck down. Baby. All right, I like it. Fuck yeah. Let's do this. We're gonna fucking get owned. Only way to get through this hard series, but I was like, well, maybe, you know, just imagine the romance option with the Blue Mask.
We should be lovers.
We can't do that.
We should be lovers, and that's a fact.
Is it a rap battle? I don't think so. I don't think Mono Sabers get involved in rap battles. Okay, 91%. Time to think of new genders. Okay, everyone. Oh, the hype is real. Let's do this shit. You only need a moment to make your decision. I accept your challenge. Commandant Hawkins' face breaks into a broad, enthusiastic grin. Then I salute you, pilot. You are courageous in choosing to face me. Now let us see if your lion's heart is matched by a lion's ferocity. Defend yourself! With that, the Imperial Mecha rushes forward, its monosaber ready to strike. Moving faster than you had even thought possible, Hawkins is upon you. This time, you are prepared for the enemy's blinding speed. As the enemy approaches once more, you quickly ask yourself...
Wait. What? We're so prepared that we have like a dragon break here. We're like,
all right, so how do I want to do this? I could fight him this way, or maybe I could pursue this tactic, or maybe I could do all about this. While you could certainly meet Hawkins' machine in close combat, the Imperial Swift machine gives him a definite advantage. You would need to either find a way to make up for the inferior speed of your machine, or hope that you are able to read your opponent's fighting style to counter his attacks before they even happen. Alternatively, you could choose to fight at range, taking advantage of your opponent's lack of any sort of gun. You would need exceptional aim to hit a target as fast as Hawkins' machine from a distance, and nerves of steel to keep firing aim shots should he try to get close. Ultimately, you'd still need a powerful ranged weapon to punch through your opponent's armor at a distance. Although your autocannon is certainly a versatile weapon, you seriously doubt its ability to get the job done in this case.
So, I guess I'll make this a poll.
This sounds pretty obvious to us based on what we have.
Little autocannon, pew pew!
Hello, Mr. Tomato. Very grimness.
Throw swords at him. Have at you! Yeah.
I think the boosters will help. I think they'll help. It's gotta be a thing.
Must be a glitch. Nice.
Okay, yeah. That's about what I figured.
Meet Hawkins' mech in close combat.
Oh boy!
When Hawkins charges in to strike, you are ready for him. As the Imperial machine's monosaber sweeps forward, your Uxbridge's hand lashes out, catching the other machine's arm before it can strike home with its deadly monomolecular blade. For a few moments, the two of you are trapped in a fruitless grapple, each trying to overpower the other with sheer force of servo motors and thrusters. Suddenly, Hawkins breaks free with an almighty heave, his machine falling into a fencer stance, liquid metal blade positioned before it. "Tell me, pilot," he says to the still-open comm channel, his eyes intent behind his mask, "why do you fight?" The question takes you by surprise. You think back to that day, an eternity ago, when you signed up to fight against Old Earth. You had a cause then, a burning in your soul, which drove you into battle. Does that same reason, that fame and glory, the fame monster, drive you still? Does it? Option 1, option 2, option 3.
Shut up, Baka.
Oh, it's pretty split across the board here. We got folks in chat who still think that we do fight for the same reasons of power and fame and success. And there's some folks who maybe aren't okay with that whole fame monster thing and want to do something else. There's a fewer number of folks who are just like, shut up and fight me.
We do have some backstory, according to what Chucklefuck Chat has selected. We're power hungry and we desire fame and glory.
Oh man, that's fairly evenly split. 37% option 1, 34% option 2, 29% option 3. This doesn't really show, like, our whole, like, detail of why we still fought, but, there we go. Yes, I still fight for the same reasons. I fight for wealth and power. I fight because it is the shortest path to my ambitions. The Imperial Ace's face twists into an odd, sardonic grin. Then you understand the truth, after a fashion, to struggle in the knowledge that every drop of blood you shed ennobles you, makes you greater. We are of a mind on this. No petty greed clouds my judgment. Hawkins shakes his head slowly. We think in the same direction, you and I, almost of a kind. A pity that you are not yet bound by the anchors of material ambition, when the purity of struggle transcends all mortal riches. Hawkins rushes for you again, his blade poised to strike. Power and riches are such empty rewards when one could fight to become greater than such things.
All right.
You examine your options as the Imperial Mecha lunges forward. Any other situation, the obvious choice would be to be aggressive, counterattacking, and forcing your opponent on the defensive. But with a pilot as skilled as Hawkins, you're not sure if that would prove to be the best thing to do. Of course, settling for a more defensive posture would prevent you from doing any damage to the enemy, but would also mean that you could probably have a better chance at avoiding damage to your own machine, provided you kept calm. It also occurs that you could use Hawkins' verbosity against him. If your opponent is too busy monologuing to put all of his focus into the fight, it'd be a lot easier to fend off his attacks. Lastly, if you are fast enough, or lucky enough, you might even be able to withdraw from close combat, putting yourself out of the reach of the enemy ace's monosaber. Alright. Choices. Option 1, option 2, option 3, and option 4. Woo!
Show stats. Piloting is 4 plus 1. Perception is 1. Willpower and presence are both 2.
We are the best at the piloting.
Weapon-wise, we have a plasma cutter melee weapon and a light autocannon.
Light autocannon doesn't do a whole lot, from what I hear.
I think I like option 1.
Chucklefuck Chad strongly disagrees.
They want this motherfucking villain to keep monologuing himself. Although he might be a savvy enough pilot to avoid doing such a thing. He might be up to such tricks, but, you know, such chicanery and tomfoolery. Wouldn't be the first time a villain had taken himself down with a monologue, right? Okay, Fluffy. That's what we're doing, 67%. You duck away from the Imperial's attack and try to distract him before he can strike again. Unfortunately, people skills aren't really your strong suit.
Wait a minute!
You shout, sounding far more desperate than you admit to.
I have questions for you!
Hawkins replies in an amused chuckle.
I'm afraid they shall have to wait. Your attempt to distract me with questioning is inspired and inept. Perhaps you will have the chance to do better the next time you attempt a war with words. You will keep in mind your errors and do better. That is, if there is a next time.
Before you can react, the Imperial Ace slams his machine into yours and grabs your Uxbridge's arm. The customs hand darts out, tearing free the exposed linkages, carrying power to your melee weapon before heaving you away. Without power, your plasma cutter is useless. You're tossed it away just in time to face his next attack. And we need to attempt to withdraw, folks, because option 1's grayed out. You hold position until the last moment before dashing out of the way of your opponent's charge. With your Uxbridge's thrusters at full power, you try to get as much distance as possible before Hawkins can recover and chase you. Answer to you. By the time you turn around, the Imperial Ace is far out of reach. Hoping that you have gained enough distance, you repair your light autocannon as the Imperial machine advances upon you again. Rest in peace, plasma cutter. Yeah, that's what we need to do. Just close in and just fucking, like, punch him.
Choices. Oh, shit. Option 1, option 2, and option 3. Go!
For the good of the city.
We just kite him around forever. Like, catch us now, motherfucker. Woo! Extra cool thrusters. 5 pilot and skill nerd. Get wrecked. Wee! Wee!
Oh, wow.
Chat. What are you doing? All right, chat, sure.
I mean, yeah, we'll just grapple him.
Cut me now when I'm hugging you, sir.
So, 48%
have selected to close in and fight Hawkins in melee. Alright. As expected, your opponent does not...
What? What? What do you mean we lunged forward with our plasma cutter? You mean the plasma cutter we threw in space? You mean that plasma cutter? You mean that fucking plasma cutter? Oh yeah, 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 fucking course. Yeah, that's what we fucking did. Yeah, fucking course that makes sense. I mean, why wouldn't we? We're a fucking sorcerer. We just teleported that shit back to our head. Ta-da, it's been fixed. Magic. Yes, Jamoni, he did. And the text specifically said, we ripped off the plasma cutter and threw it away. We no longer have it. We threw it off. We only had one. That's why we couldn't fight aggressively. We had to run. You can't fucking bullshit your way out of this, Chad. Don't fucking try to make excuses for the game.
Aha, that wasn't my real plasma cutter. Fool! You fell respawn.
As expected, your opponent does not try to stop you when you draw your plasma cutter and meet his rapid advance with a charge of your own. The enemy ace swings first. His blade lashes out for your Uxbridge's head. With a burst of your thrusters, you duck out of the way and lunge forward with your plasma cutter. Your strike meets only empty vacuum as your opponent shifts aside. Both of you bring your weapons up again. Before Hawkins can strike again, you become aware of an incessant beeping. It is only when the Valier custom pulls up short that you realize it is coming from the other end of your comlink with the Imperial machine. The Imperial ace pulls back and sheathes his blade. His expression is almost apologetic as he looks up at you.
I'm afraid I must cut our dance short, pilot.
The Imperial gives you a sad little grin. To interrupt our engagement pains me greatly. You're one of the finest pilots I have ever had the honor to face on the field of battle. With that, the Valier custom turns around and retreats for the fleeing shapes of the Imperial task force.
I look forward to our next encounter, pilot.
Are you fucking kidding me?
The space over Vedria is strangely calm as you watch the Imperial machine recede into the blackness of space. In the distance, you can see clouds of debris and bodies where the fighting had been hardest, floating almost toy-like in the microgravity of orbit. Only the dark shapes of the fleet remain. You suppose that means your side won this one. With the battle over, there remains nothing left to do besides return your machine to the safety of the Caliburn's hangar deck. The last of your combat adrenaline leaves you as you set your Uxbridge gently onto the Caliburn's recovery deck. Sudden wave of exhaustion hits you as your machine is slowly lowered through the hangar elevator to the airlock. You can barely stay alert as the telltale hiss of atmosphere fills the pressure chamber and the sounds of the hangar bay begin to filter through the quickly thickening atmosphere outside of your machine. By the time the airlock opens, you are operating in a post-combat fugue, barely even noticing or recognizing the secured bulk of the white prototype mecha as you pass it into hangar bay and head for your own machine's berth. Your eyelids heavy and your breath coming heavily, you set down your machine in the maintenance dock. Your mind goes through the shutdown check slowly as if it were swimming in mud. Finally, the last of your displays shut down, leaving your cockpit lit only by the small emergency lights on your suit. We only have a few minutes more left with Mecha Ace here. With a high-pitched hiss, your machine's cockpit slides open. The sounds and lights of the Caliburn's hangar deck assault your senses. You take a deep breath and pull yourself out of your machine. You have reached a checkpoint. Should you wish to, you may save your progress in the story here. You may return to a save checkpoint at any time from the stat screen. Would you like to save your progress? Why, thank you, Paul Wang. As a matter of fact, I would like to save my progress, sir. Although this sounds like something that would allow us to, like, rewind. I don't know. I'm sure the game would save automatically, like the hero... Like, Rice has made saves, but I just closed out of the game. But what the hell?
Progress saved. Interlude. Well, we'll have to wait for that interlude, folks.
We won't get too much more involved in that. This mech ace, I think we're going to have to go through that again on a Thursday. That was certainly a thing that transpired there.
We have like our own checkpoint we can return to. Neat. Yeah. Yeah, how about that? Mecha ace. That's pretty cool. I'm still kind of confused where that second plasma cutter came from.
But alright, Mecha ace. We did it, everyone. Go team.
It's pretty entertaining. It's pretty good. Pretty good, I like that. I think that was a worthwhile pick to do for live broadcast. Democracy, the choices, the Chuckle Fuck Democracy definitely made that pretty enjoyable. It's pretty good. Okay. Anyway, folks, I am going to go on break for some time. Let's see here. The itinerary down below does say that the break will go for until the 20 of the hour, where we will do soundboard fun. The Typing of the Dead with Interactive Soundboard, the feature that I know some of you have really been waiting for. It's going to be entertaining, I think. Yeah, it's not, I guess we'll get fucked. Anyway, I'll be right back. No music to accompany this one. Just gonna step away. And see you later. Ah, who am I kidding? We'll have some music. Thank you.
machine.
You're just a machine.
I know. I'm tremendous. I'm absolutely tremendous. Okay. So I found a key on the few keys I kicked out that actually worked. Very pleased. Very pleased. Oh, God damn it! I forgot to stop the local recording again. Jesus, Grimith.